the Livingston County War Museum. My name is Don Fortna. I'm a Navy veteran, and I'm also a lover of World War II fighter planes. And this is my collection behind me here. As a teenager, I fell in love with fighter planes, and I read everything I could get my hands on. And to make a long story short, over the last 25 or 30 years, I have collected over 125 books on the subject, and I got 70 of them right here. I like to think that I'm somewhat of an aficionado, but that's my opinion. I started collecting them about 25 years ago, and they're all carved out of solid mahogany. They're museum quality, and the first one I bought was the Spitfire in 1986. They built over 100 fighter planes in World War II, but there are only 25 of those worth a toot, and I've got the 25. I want to bring your attention to a couple items before I talk about my planes. One item is a certificate of recognition that I got from the Illinois Senate, and I really appreciated that. And the other item I want to talk about is a friend of mine, Raleigh Gagnon. He was a Navy veteran of World War II. He was on the destroyer Earl, and he made 16 trips back and forth across the Atlantic protecting convoys against submarines. And on two different ones, his destroyer sank two submarines. And Raleigh purchased this glass case behind me and donated it for my fighter planes, and I really appreciate that. World War II was the first war where air power was an important and integral part. The Battle of Britain was all done by air. Summer of 1940, Hitler was trying to bomb England into submission, and he didn't get the job done. Pearl Harbor was all done by air, no ground troops, in 1941. And at the end of the war, the atomic bomb was dropped on Hiroshima, and that was done by air. So air power was an important part in World War II. Someone has defined the life of a fighter pilot as consisting of hours and hours of boredom and interspersed with seconds of stark terror, and I think that's true. This is a Russian Yak, and there's a lily painted on the side of the cockpit and a lily on the other side. Russia was the only nation in World War II that had women fighter pilots. The lady that flew this plane, her name was Lilia Latvik, and of course Lilia means lily, and that's why the lily's on the side of the cockpit. And she was a blonde, she was good looking, she was eccentric. Every time she flew, she carried a fresh can of flowers in her cockpit. And to become an ace, you had to shoot down 5 enemy planes. Lily shot down 12 before she was shot down and killed. There was one other double ace in World War II. Her name was Katerina Budnova, and she shot down 12 before she was shot down and killed. And both of those ladies won the Hero of the Soviet Union medal, which is the highest medal that Russia gives out. Russia also had women bomber pilots. And the bomber pilots flew the old biplane, the two-wing biplane, canvas, open cockpits, and they flew at night, and they flew in threes, one about a mile ahead of the other two, and they flew over the German lines, and when they'd get to the German lines, the Germans would turn on their searchlights, and when they found that lead plane, the lead plane would do some fancy aerobatics and get out of the way, and the two planes following the leader could see where the searchlights were, so they would shut their engines off and glide down over those searchlights and drop fragmentary bombs. And they killed a lot of Germans that way, and the Germans hated them. They called them the night witches. And of those night witches, 23 received the Hero of the Soviet Union medal, the highest medal that Russia gives out. Stalin put out an order number 270, which said that if any Russian surrenders to the enemy, their families, siblings will all be sent to the gulag in Siberia and never to be heard from again. And so the night witches didn't carry parachutes because they knew if they parachuted from their plane and was alive and was captured, then their siblings and parents would be sent to Siberia. So they carried no chutes. And of the night witches, 30 of them were killed in action, and 23 received the Hero of the Soviet Union medal, the highest medal that Russia gives out. Now, I want to talk about the Lightning, P-38 Lightning. I'm sure that most of you people know who Charles Lindbergh was. He was the first man to fly from New York to Paris in 1927. And in 1936, Hitler invited Lindbergh to Germany to review the new German Air Force. And while he was there, Hitler gave him a medal for flying from New York to Paris in 1927. And Lindbergh comes back home, and he was very vocal. He joined the America First movement in this country, and the American First movement in this country said, stay out of the war in Europe. We went over there in World War I. We're not going back in World War II. And he was very vocal about this. So when 1939 came along, and it looks like we're going to be in war, Lindbergh enlisted in the Air Force, and they wouldn't take him. And he tried the Navy, and they wouldn't take him because our president thought he was a Nazi and wouldn't let him in any of our air forces. So Lindbergh goes to work for the people that make the Corsair, the Fu-4 Corsair, and they sent him to the South Pacific. And while he was there, he went to Guadalcanal, and he went on some combat missions with the fighter pilots on Guadalcanal, and he was flying the P-38 Lightning. And every time they'd go on a combat mission, when they'd get back home, he would have 100 gallon more gas in his gas tank than the other pilots. And he showed them how to get more mileage out of the P-38 Lightning while he was there. And on several of those missions, on two different ones I should say, he actually shot down a Japanese plane. But he couldn't tell anybody about it because Roosevelt would have had somebody's head because Lindbergh was still a civilian. Another story about the Lightning. Yamamoto was the Japanese admiral who planned the attack on Pearl Harbor. He was a student at Harvard University for 1 or 2 years. He was a very disciplined military man and very punctual. And just prior to the Battle of Midway, we deciphered the Japanese radio code and we were reading their messages. And we won the Battle of Midway. About 6 months later, we intercepted a message that Yamamoto was going to be at Bougainville Navy Base at 9:30 in the morning on April 18, 1943, and we knew he'd be there at 9:30. Guadalcanal is down here, Bougainville is up here, 450-mile difference, a string of islands. We take off with 16 Lightnings, we fly out 50 miles, wave top level, come up 450 miles, come back in, no GPS, ran into two Japanese Betty bombers, shot them both down, and killed Yamamoto. Upon the death, and we couldn't tell anybody that we killed Yamamoto, because if we did, they know we broke their code. Thunderbolt. It was the heaviest, biggest single-engine fighter plane ever built. Most of our fighter planes weighed about 6,000 to 7,000 pounds. When this one came along, it weighed 10,000 pounds. And it had armor plating, and it turned out to be just a great airplane. And when the pilots transitioned from these other planes to the P-47, when they first saw it, they wondered, will that thing fly? And they nicknamed it the Jug, the Tank, and pardon my French, the Big Ass Bird. But it turned out to be just a great airplane, and it was flying in England. A guy by the name of Gabby Grabeski was flying it. His parents were Polish immigrants. He was born in this country. And if you remember, Hitler invaded Poland first, and Gabby didn't like the Germans. Anyway, he became a fighter pilot flying the P-47 in England, protecting bombers to and from Germany. And when he shot down his 28th German plane, he became the top Allied ace in Germany. And they were going to send him home to see if we could get some public relations out of him, sell him war bonds. And he was going home the day after tomorrow. He was engaged to be married, and as soon as he got home, and he was leaving the day after tomorrow. And then they posted a mission for tomorrow. And Gabby thought, what the heck, one more won't hurt anything. So he took this one more mission. And it was just a short run into Germany. No, they didn't run into any opposition, no fighter planes or anything. But on the way home, if a fighter pilot has ammunition left and gas, and if there's anything moving on the ground, they peel off, strafe it. And Gabby looked down and he saw a German airfield. He peeled off, went down across that airfield, guns blazing, shooting up everything on the ground, and he was so low that his propeller hit the ground, and he crash-landed about 2 miles away. He became a prisoner of war and for about 4 or 5 months, but he did survive the war. He did get home. He did get married. He stayed in the service and went to Korea and during the Korean War, and he became an ace in Korea, shot down six MiGs in Korea. P-51 Mustang. That is arguably our best plane. After the invasion of Normandy, the largest land battle in Europe in World War II was the Battle of the Bulge. I think there was something like 80,000 casualties in the Battle of the Bulge. And General Eisenhower was the supreme commander of Allied forces in World War II, and he wanted to see the battlefield before the battle. And so the Mustang, they modified the cockpit of the Mustang. There was a 50-gallon gas tank behind the pilot. They took that out, they put in a bucket seat, put Eisenhower in the bucket seat, put the lid back on, and flew him all around the Ardennes forest in Belgium and France before the Battle of the Bulge. Therefore, Eisenhower is the only ground general ever to see the battlefield before the battle in the presence of enemies. Another story about the Mustang. There was a guy by the name of Bill Overstreet, and he was flying P-51 Mustang, protecting bombers over Germany. He was flying at 30,000 feet, and they ran into a swarm of Messerschmitt 109s, German, and he got in a dogfight, and he got on the tail of a Messerschmitt, and he was up at 30,000 feet, and the Messerschmitt dove clear down to ground level, and they were over Paris, and the Messerschmitt went down a street in Paris, and Bill Overstreet was right on his tail, and the Messerschmitt went through and under the Eiffel Tower, thinking that the American wouldn't follow him, but Bill Overstreet followed him under, came out the other side, and shot him down. And the French people, citizens of Paris, saw this, and it really increased and boosted their morale because they had been under Hitler's handle for a long time. And so anyway, after the war, Overstreet was given the highest French medal that they give out, the Legion of Honor, and he received it after the war. The other story about the Mustang, Chuck Yeager was a double ace, World War II, flying the Mustang. I think, if I remember correctly, he shot down 11 enemy planes. But he is more noted for after the war. He was the first man in the Bell X-1 jet to break the sound barrier, 750 mile an hour. The P-40 Warhawk was the only plane that was fought at the beginning of the war, flying, and at the end of the war. At Pearl Harbor, during the attack by the Japanese, two young men got in the air flying the P-40, a guy by the name of Taylor and a guy by the name of Welch. And between those two, they shot down six Japanese planes during the attack of Pearl Harbor. The P-40 also fought in China with the AVG, the American Volunteer Group, more notably known as the Flying Tigers. We sent 100 pilots and 100 planes to China before the attack on Pearl Harbor to help Chinese start a new Air Force. And while they were there, after they were there a couple months, we sent a reporter over there to do a story on them. And the reporter said, those guys fight like tigers. And the name stuck, and they became known as the Flying Tigers, and with the sharp nose painted on their planes. This is the French Doigtin. France was conquered in 6 weeks, but France had a good fighter plane. And there was a young man by the name of Pierre Laglone, and he was flying the Doigtin in northern France when Hitler attacked France. And he shot down four Messerschmitts. And then Italy declared war on France, and they moved Pierre from northern France to southern France, and now he's fighting against the Italians. And he shot down seven Italian planes, the Machi. And then the war was over. And they shipped him from southern France to Syria, which at that time, 1940, was a French colony. And while he was in Syria, now he's fighting for the Vichy government, he shoots down seven Hurricanes. So he is the only pilot in the world to shoot down enemy planes from three different countries. He shot down four Germans, seven Italians, and seven British. And then the war is over in the Mediterranean, still going on in Europe. So over in the Mediterranean, and he comes and he's flying for us. And he's flying the P-39 Air Cobra, and he's flying along the Mediterranean coast, North Africa, and his engine quit. And so he just radioed that he was going to land on the beach, which he did. But he forgot, because he wasn't used to carrying a gas tank, auxiliary gas tank, underneath his plane, and he was carrying one underneath the P-39 that he was flying, and he forgot to drop it before he landed, and of course when he landed it blew up, and that was the end of Pierre. But Pierre was one of the top aces of France, shot down 18 enemy planes from three different countries. This is a bent-winged bird, the F-4U Corsair. And it was called the bent-winged bird because of the shape of the wing. But there's a reason they shaped it that way. The wheels, when they were down, they were on the outside of the wing. And when the wheels were down and it was on landing on the ground, it kept the fuselage that much higher off the ground because the propeller was 14 feet 8 inches in diameter. That's almost as big as this room. And it also had another name. The Japanese called it Whistling Death, because in a dive it made a whistling sound. And during in the 1980s, there was a TV program called Baba Black Sheep, and it was a story of the Corsair on Guadalcanal and Pappy Boyington. Pappy Boyington was a one-quarter Cherokee Indian, and he was flying on Guadalcanal and flying the Corsair. He was a great pilot. He flew with the Flying Tigers in China before he got to Guadalcanal, and while he was flying with the Flying Tigers, he shot down 5 Japanese planes. Now he's on Guadalcanal flying the Corsair, and when he shot down, he had 28 kills. He was the highest Marine ace in World War II, and he got shot down himself over a ball and was picked up by a Japanese sub, and the Japanese sub took him to Tokyo, and he spent a year and several months in a prisoner of war camp in Tokyo. But he also won the Medal of Honor, our highest medal. This is a Bf 109 Messerschmitt. It was the most produced airplane, fighter plane, of any fighter plane in the world. They built over 35,000 of them, and most of the top aces in Germany flew the Bf 109. But the sad part about it is, the world was so sick of war by the time it ended that they scrapped and cut up for scrap every German plane they could get their hands on, and they never saved any for museums. And so in today, there's only about 2 original Bf 109s in the world. This is a Japanese Tony. During World War II, Germany and Japan were allies, and Japanese wanted a plane like the Messerschmitt 109 that they built 35,000 of them. So Germany took a 109 apart, put it on a submarine, took the submarine all the way around Africa, all the way to Japan, and delivered it to Japan, and Japan re-engineered it, and this is what they came up with, the Tony. And it turned out to be a great plane for Japan, but it came too late in the war. And when the Americans first fought against it, they thought it was a Messerschmitt by the silhouette, but it was a really formidable plane for Japan in World War II. This is a Messerschmitt 262. It is the only operational jet in World War II, German, and the general of German fighter planes is a guy by the name of Adolf Galland. And when he first flew the 262, he said when he got airborne and opened the throttle, he thought he was being pushed by angels. It was so fast. The Messerschmitt 262 would go 540 mile an hour, which was 100 mile an hour faster than propeller-driven planes, but it came too late in the war, and it only shot down about 500 enemy planes. Messerschmitt 163 Comet. It is a rocket-powered plane, and Germany had the only rocket-powered plane in World War II. And you see the wheels underneath it, the big wheels? It was a dolly. And as soon as the pilot got airborne, he pulled a lever and the wheel dropped away. Because in World War II, all the airfields were dirt and grass. And the bottom of the plane was a skid. And the rocket plane only had enough fuel for 15 minutes. And the number one job of a fighter plane is to shoot down bombers. And to have an advantage in shooting down a bomber, you want to be above them. Bombers flew at 25,000 feet, so you wanted to be at 30,000 feet when you attacked. Propeller-driven planes, it would take 15 minutes to get from ground level to 30,000 feet. The Comet, 2 minutes and 40 seconds from ground level to 30,000 feet. But it only had fuel for 15 minutes. So it'd make 2 passes at the bombers, run out of gas, glide down and land on the grass one runway. But it came too late in the war, and it only shot down 2 B-17 bombers. Another comment about the Comet. See the propellant on it? very small. We get classes in here all the time, young people, and I'll tell them my story about the comet. And a little girl standing here says to me, "Boy, that's a little propeller for that airplane." And I said, "Yeah, it is, but it has nothing to do with the power of the airplane, because rocket power is no engine." And so they put a generator that the propeller whirled, and the generator created the electricity to operate the controls on the plane. So that's why the little propeller in the front of that comet. This is the F-4F Wildcat. I want to take you back to the South Pacific, 1942, we're on the aircraft carrier Lexington. Radar picks up 9 enemy bombers headed right for them. We launch 6 Wildcats to intercept. We launch them in 2s, and the first 2 to get to the bombers, the leader shot down 5 of those 9. He became an ace in a day, shot down 5 planes. And for that, he won the Congressional Medal of Honor. And his name was Edward Butch O'Hare. And they named O'Hare Field in Chicago after him. But a year later, he was on a night mission and he didn't come home. We don't know what happened to him. Another little piece of trivia about Butch O'Hare, his father was an attorney in Chicago, and he ran and did the books on about 3 horse racing tracks for Al Capone. And he squealed on Al Capone, and of course Al Capone wound up in Alcatraz, but Al Capone had his henchman shoot Butch O'Hare's father right here with a shotgun blast. Just a little piece of trivia on the side. F-6 Hellcat. It replaced the Wildcat, and it turned out to be a great plane. During the Battle of the Philippine Sea, also known as the Mariana Turkey Shoot, the kill ratio with that and the Japanese Zeros was 19 to 1. During the Battle of the Mariana Turkey Shoot, that plane shot down 429 Japanese planes with a loss of only 29 of our own. The other thing about the Wildcat and the Mariana Turkey Shoot, when the battle started, Admiral Spruance scout planes found the Japanese armada in the Pacific Ocean. And remember, the Pacific Ocean is a big place. But it was 3 o'clock or 2:30 around that in the afternoon when they found the Japanese armada and radioed back where it was. And Admiral Spruance knew that if he launched an attack on that armada, and there were 2 or 3 carriers in that armada, and he wanted them, that it would be dark when the pilots got back home. But he decided to call for a strike. And so they launched 80-some planes to intercept the Japanese armada, and they didn't get off the flight deck till about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. They got to the Japs, a big battle, sank 1 Japanese aircraft carrier, damaged another one, but on the way home it got dark, and dark on the ocean is dark. You can't tell the water from the horizon, from the sky, and you want to remember that fighter pilots were 19, 20-year-old kids. And on the way home, when it got dark, they were radioing, "Where are you? We can't find you." And some of the pilots were even crying because they couldn't find their plane. And so there was an admiral by the name of Mitzker, and he is famous for his quote of, "Turn on the lights." And so he had the ships in the American armada turn on their lights, which could be seen from 60 miles away, and the pilots saw the lights, got back, and to make a long story short, for the 80 that took off to go against the Japanese, we got 60 of them back, and we only lost about 16 pilots and something like 29 or 30 crewmen. But it was really a gutsy call for Mitzger, because to turn on the lights in the Pacific Ocean at night, if there's any Japanese subs around, they would have picked off those aircraft carriers one by one. But evidently there was none around, because he got away with it. This is a British Hurricane. In World War II, when it started, the Battle of Britain, June 1940, was all done by air. Hitler tried to bomb England into submission. And we had 244 young men in this country that wanted to fly the Spitfire and the Hurricane. But it's against the law to fight for another country. It didn't make any difference with these 244. They went from here to Canada, from Canada to England, and got in the Royal Air Force. One of those men was a guy by the name of Billy Fisk. He was a two-time winner of a gold medal in 1928 and 1932, bobsled driver. He loved fast things. He went to England and got in the Air Force, and he was flying the Hawker Hurricane during the Battle of Britain, and he was flying, got in a dogfight over London, and his plane got shot up, but he was okay. And he nursed his plane back to the airfield, and just as he landed, it caught fire, and before they got him out, it burned his hands and his feet. And they got him to the hospital and thought he was going to be all right, but not that night he died from shock. So Billy Fisk is the first American to die in World War II before we were even in it. And they buried him in a little cemetery in Box Grove, England, and on his tombstone it reads, "An American citizen who died that England might live." And for years and years afterward, on every 4th of July, somebody put fresh flowers on his grave. Now I want to talk about aces. Remember I told you that to become an ace you had to shoot down 5 enemy planes. Our leading ace in America was a guy by the name of Richard Baum. And Richard Baum was flying the Lightning, the twin tail Lightning. He shot down 40 enemy planes. The leading British fighter pilot was a guy by the name of Johnny Johnson. He shot down 38 Germans. The leading Russian ace was Ivan Kizadub. He shot down 66 German planes. And the leading Japanese ace was a guy by the name of Nishizawa. And Nishizawa, flying the Zero, shot down 87. So 87 is the top ace so far. Now I want to talk about Germans. Hitler sent his fighter pilots to Spain in 1936 to help Franco in the Spanish Civil War. And so his fighter pilots flew from 1936 to 1945, the end of the war. Our fighter pilots, when they got so many missions or so many kills, they sent them home to sell war bonds and get a little propaganda out of them. German fighter pilots had to fly until they were killed or wounded and couldn't fly. So they flew from 36 to 45, 9 years. The leading ace so far, Nishizawa, 87. The leading German ace, Erich Hartmann. His nickname was Bubby because he looked like a little boy. He was also called the Blonde Knight of Germany. But he shot down 352 enemy planes. The ace of all aces. And the sad story about Erich is that at the end of the war, his airfield surrendered to the Americans, and the Americans turned him back over to the Russians, and the Russians kept him and his crew for 10 years at hard labor in a prisoner of war camp. But they did survive. One more story I want to tell you about Spitfire. There was a guy by the name of Douglas Botter, an Englishman, who was a stunt pilot before the war, flying the old biplane. And he was doing stunts in 1936, and he did a loop too close to the ground, and he crashed. And he lost both legs, one below the knee and one above the knee. This was 1936. When 1939 came along, it looked like England was going to be in the war. Douglas went to the Royal Air Force and asked him if they'd give him a shot at flying a fighter plane. Oh, by the way, they made 10 legs for him. He had 2 10 legs. And the RAF gave him a chance, and he became a fighter pilot. And he shot down 22 German planes before he was shot down. He was called the Legless Wonder. And when he got shot down over France, he bailed out, and one leg caught on the side of the cockpit, and the other one got mashed, but he did parachute safely to the ground. And every evening back in the 1940s, at the beginning of the war, London radio would broadcast out in the open every night how many German planes they shot down, how many planes they lost during that day. And so they broadcast that night that the Legless Wonder didn't come home. Douglas Botter didn't come home. He was on a fighter mission and never returned. And the general of German fighters, Adolf Galland, of course, Germany listened to all the reports coming out of London radio at night. Adolf Galland heard that report, and so he put out the word in France, where all of the German airfields were, if anybody picked up Galland. And he found he was in a prisoner of war camp. And so he sent some soldiers to the prisoner of war camp, picked up Galland, brought him back to the airfield, and he wined him and dined him that night. Of course, at the beginning of the war, there was still some chivalry around. And so the two, all they did was talk about airplanes. That's what fighter pilots talk about. And so in a conversation, Douglas Botter told Galland, he says, I got another pair of legs in England if I could get them. And Galland says, okay. He says, we'll just radio London out in the open and tell them if they'll put your leg in a parachute and drop them over to this airport at 10:30 in the morning, nobody will shoot at them. And so they did. And Douglas got his legs back. Two nights later, he tried to escape. They caught him, put him back in prison. About 2 weeks later, he tried again, and they caught him and put him back. And after that, every time it got dark, they took his legs away from him. He spent the rest of the time in the prisoner of war camp. He did survive the war. And after the war, he was knighted by Queen Elizabeth, not for his fighter pilot heroics, but for working with handicapped children. Knighted by the King, Queen of England. One more story about the Spitfire. There was a man by the name of John McGee, who was born in Shanghai, China. His parents were missionaries. And when he became high school age, they sent him back to the United States for his high school education. And when he graduated from high school, he, instead of going to college, he decided that he wanted to fly for Canada. And so he went to the Royal Canadian Air Force, and took flight training, became a pilot, and then Canada shipped him to England right after the Battle of Britain. And he was on a training mission with three other pilots flying Spitfires, and they were above the clouds. When they got through with the training mission, they headed back toward the airfield, and they had to drop down through the clouds to get to their airfield. And when they dropped down through the clouds, John McGee collided with another airplane, and he and the other pilot were killed. And this was December the 11th, 4 days after Pearl Harbor, that John McGee was killed. But he was not only a fighter pilot, he was a poet. And about 3 months before he was killed, he wrote a poem called High Flight. And he sent the poem home to his parents. And High Flight became the official poem of the Royal Canadian Air Force. It became the official poem of the Royal Air Force. And I want to share several lines with you. President Reagan shared several lines of that poem with the public when the spacecraft Challenger blew up. Anyway, and I would imagine that if you'd go to any military airfield in the country, you'd find this poem somewhere. And he called the poem High Flight, and it goes something like this. Oh, I have slipped the surly bonds of earth and danced the skies on laughter-silvered wings and done 100 things you have not dreamed of. I have topped the sun-swept clouds with easy grace, where never a lark or even an eagle flew. And there, with a silent, uplifting mind, I've trod, put out my hand, and touched the face of God. John McGee was 19 years old when he was killed. And I like to think of death as coming in three stages. The first stage is when all bodily functions cease. The second stage is when they bury you. And the third stage is the last time your name is mentioned. I just mentioned John McGee's name. And I think it's important that we keep mentioning their names and remembering their deeds, even if it is in the abstract. I don't want to leave you on a solemn note, so I want to give you three pieces of trivia. The first piece of trivia is Tojo. Tojo was the general of the Japanese army. He was also the prime minister. And at the end of the war, we put him on trial for crimes against humanity, and we hung him. But let me back up a second. At the end of the war, a doctor put an X on his chest and gave Tojo a gun, and Tojo committed harakiri, shot himself, but he missed his heart, and they recuperated him, and he lived, and they put him on trial. The war was over in 1945, and we hung him in 1948. During that three-year period, Tojo had really bad teeth. In fact, he only had one upper tooth. He had his bottom tooth, but he only had one upper tooth. And an American dentist pulled that upper tooth and made Tojo an upper plate. And if you remember what an upper plate looks like, it's got a roof to it. And as a little trick, the dentist decided to put a message on Tojo's uppers in Morse code, dots and dashes. He put a message, Tojo's uppers. What did the message say? Remember Pearl Harbor. And when we hung him, he was wearing those teeth. The other piece of trivia, this is 1936. We're in Germany on Hitler's private train. Nowadays, heads of state have private planes like Air Force One. Back in 1940, it was a train. And Hitler's private train had two locomotives. It had anti-aircraft cars, it had soldiers, guards, it had dining cars, sleeping cars, and even he had a carload of women, ladies of the evening, that went right along with the train. What did he name his train? He named his train America, because he really liked Henry Ford. Henry Ford sold Hitler trucks in the late 30s, and Hitler was inspired by Henry Ford's assembly line. And the story goes that Henry Ford donated some money to Hitler during his political campaign. And Hitler had a picture of Henry Ford hanging in his office in Germany. So anyway, Hitler named his train America. When 1939 came along and it looked like we were going to be in the war, Hitler changed the name from America to Brandenburg. But originally, Hitler named his private train America. One more piece of trivia. What did General Patton and Winston Churchill have in common? During World War II, early part of World War II, Hitler made the boast that nobody would ever cross the Rhine. Well, we crossed the Rhine in World War II. And the thing that Patton and Winston Churchill had in common, both of them peed in the Rhine River. And the reason they peed in the river is to let Hitler know that we're going to cross the river and we're going to defeat Nazism. I want to thank you for coming. Come back again and visit us, because we're always adding something new. And have a great day.
And here with a song of the Army Air Corps is Bing Crosby.
Off we go into the wild blue yonder. Keep the wings level and true. If you'd live to be a gray-haired wonder, keep the nose out of the blue. Flying men guarding the nation's border, we'll be there, followed by more. In echelon, we carry on. Nothing will stop the Army Air Corps. Here's a toast to the host of those who love the vastness of the sky. To a friend, we send a message of his brother men who fly. We drink to those who gave their all of old. Then down we roar to score the rainbow's pot of gold. A toast to the host of men we boast, the Army Air Corps.
Off we go into the wild blue yonder. Keep the wings level and true. If you live to be a gray-haired wonder, keep the nose out of the blue.
Flying men guarding the nation's border, we'll be there, followed by more. In echelon, we carry on. Nothing will stop the Army Air Corps. Nothing will stop the Army Air Corps.